A very good morning to our distinguished speakers and participants from all over India. On behalf of Department of Sociology, Nizam College, Usmania University, I extend a very, very warm welcome to all our distinguished speakers and participants. Friends, we are beginning today's webinar with the presentation of Dr. Kathy Raisonji. Since sir has to go for an important meeting, so we thought that we should begin with his presentation. This series is also being telecasted live on being live stream on YouTube as well, and this particular edition was very, very significant as part of the webinar series on development studies, because India is land of villages. You cannot discuss about India and about development of India without discussing about its villages. And with regard to tribal population, 8.2% of Indian population is tribal. So friends, we will in coming two and a half hours, we will deliberate on various aspects with regard to rural and tribal development in India. Without further delay, because Dr. Kathy Raison has to leave for the meeting, I welcome Dr. Kathy Raison, and I take it my privilege to introduce Dr. Kathy Raison is Associate Professor and Head, Center for Panchayati Raj, National Institute for Rural Development and Panchayati Raj, Hyderabad. He's a development professional with 16 plus years of experience in public and private sectors, and he understands the processes involved in pro-poor information and knowledge systems at the grassroots level. He has experience in implementing ICT for development related research and development projects in agriculture and rural development, Internet of Things in agriculture, and precision farming projects. He is PhD in agriculture from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore. Presently, he is associated with National Institute of Rural Development and Panchayati Raj, Hyderabad, as Associate Professor and Head, Center for Panchayati Raj. He also guides a team of professionals working in projects related to strengthening Panchayati Raj system, particularly CBNT for preparation of Gram Panchayat Development Plan, e-Panchayats, and online training of Panchayat functionaries. Previously, he was associated with Center for Development of Advanced Computing, CDAC, Ministry of Information Technology, Government of India, for 11 years, and developing knowledge systems under India Development Gateway Project, Wikaspedia Knowledge Portal. Sir, I have no words enough to thank you for your gracious presence and your sharing of experience with our participants will definitely provide a new perspective to this entire series, sir. So over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anita. I think, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are very clear.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you all, Dr. Vinita Pandey. First of all, very good morning to all, and I'm very grateful to the university for inviting me to be with you for next half an hour to 45 minutes and share some of the aspects what my institution, the National Institute of Rural Development and Panchayati Raj, particularly my department, the Center for Panchayati Raj, is doing at the national perspective level. As Dr. Pandey Madam is very elaborately explaining this thing, so I come from a background of agriculture. I am an agriculture graduate, basically, and gone with different aspects in working in villages, in the private sectors. Then 11 years, I worked in ICT for development, information communication technology for development, associated with the Ministry of Information Technology under CDAC, Center for Development of Advanced Computing, where I was working very closely with developing applications for rural development. So many IT applications, how best we can bring IT solutions to the rural development area. So that was our main area of work for me. And one of the important website or portal, some people might have come across during your some search in the local language, you might have come across one of the portal called Vikaspedia. Okay, it is available in 22 languages. We developed during the CDAC period. That is one of the most utilized portal in 22 languages in India. Okay, so after that, I switched over my work from CDAC to NIRDPR. I joined in 2017, and almost last 3 years I am associated with the Center for Panchayati Raj in this institution. And last 3 years is really a great experience for our team, particularly for me, working very closely with the Ministry of Panchayati Raj and the Ministry of Rural Development in understanding the nitty-gritties of the rural development perspective and the issues and how the important schemes and other thing, how the what is the fulcrum of Panchayati Raj institution, how it is penetrated, and think what are the issues and how vibrant the rural community are doing. All things we are observing, not only we are learning, and also we are continuously in a training mode. Actually, we train the different master trainers and also the people, rural functionary, development functionaries working at village level. In all level, our institution trains actually. So when madam was inviting me for to share with you and to share my experience in the domain of rural development, particularly Panchayati Raj, I thought of actually initially going too much into the general aspects of rural development perspective and other thing. I thought of sharing the practical issues. It means the real importance of the Panchayati Raj system in perspective to the role of Panchayati Raj system with perspective to rural development. And what are the things that are happening in the ground level, keeping in mind the central government, so that we are working very closely with the Ministry of Panchayati Raj and Rural Development. So what are the real agenda for next 10 years, next 5 years from the ministry, and what is our role as a national institute, NIRDPR, what we are doing, and people who are associated in the rural development perspective, who are coming from villages, and who are associated with Panchayati Raj system, are the research scholars in the university, whole Osmania University community. You should have some ideas there, what is happening there in the Panchayat Raj system in India. So I thought of, I'll restrict my views and other things next 15-20 minutes only to share those aspects of Panchayat Raj system and what is the main focus area of Panchayat Raj system present day actually. So in that context, I would like to just straight away, I'll go with the my presentation, and please, I want to keep this presentation in the back end and start explaining the things in a little slow manner, actually. Madam, is it this, my slides are visible for you?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
No problem, no, I can go ahead. Right? Mm.
Yes,
if you have any problem, you're not able to see the slide or anything, no?
Yeah.
Please feel free me to stop. And
surely, sir, surely. Okay.
Friends, I already told actually something. So it will be better. I thought actually I can focus much on the Panchayati Raj institution system and what is the key role it's playing in the overall rural development perspective. So in this context, I will just go through certain things and we will go in detail later after 10-15 minutes of my presentation. So that will be the my idea of making the presentation today. So let me go through one by one. Friends, everybody knows that actually. So the Gram Swaraj, concept of Gram Swaraj is brought by our great Mahatma Gandhiji. So he always says that the greater the power of the Panchayat, the better for the people. Actually, the concept of Panchayat itself emerged from the Gandhian perspective under the Gram Swaraj. So we always take this as one of the main key things, and this is becoming reality. It's not a thing like that, every urban development, everything, something. Panchayat is the real fulcrum, the lifeline of India actually. Without the Panchayati Raj system and without the Panchayat existing this thing, we cannot reach the real rural development perspective in our villages and other actually. Okay. See, I would like to just go with the ma'am, can you, somebody can some screen, no? It's so many participants are coming online.
Yeah, so we are taking care of that.
Taking
sir.
Care of this.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Please go ahead with the presentation.
Yeah. Okay. So if you see that real federal structure of Indian these things, particularly when you go to from the union government to the panchayat level, this is the things you know very well. Actually, there are two important constitutional amendment happened in the year 1993. One is for Panchayat Raj, another is for municipality. 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act, which is for the Panchayat Raj system, and 74th Constitutional Amendment, which was for the municipality actually. So after the union government and state government, these two systems very clearly stipulated, and after 1993, it is very much implemented in the all level actually. The Panchayat Raj institution, if you see there, it's a three-tier system, starting from Jilla Panchayat, Block Panchayat, then Gram Panchayat, three levels we say, GP, BP, and ZP we call, okay, or District Panchayat we call. In the municipality structure, it is a Nagar Panchayat, Municipal Council, and Municipal Corporation. This is the constitutionally made this thing. Apart from that, in the constitution, there is an autonomous councils in the tribal areas also. Particularly, we have the tribal belt in 10 important states, which I am coming back a little later. And also, we are having northeastern states, 4-5 states in the northeastern, typically governed by the autonomous councils. So those are the things, the structure you should understand that what is happening now actually, okay? So friends, this particular slide, I would like to give you an overall picture, something as and today, present day, what is the Panchayat Raj institutions, how many Panchayat Raj institutions are existing in the country? You know that we are talking about Panchayat and other thing, but we should know that this is one of the biggest, the largest local government system in the world. No other country has this many elected representatives, this many people are working on the ground level in 2,71,611. This is the total number as on today, okay? This many PRIs. PRIs, I want to say that don't keep in mind only Gram Panchayat. I'm including the PRI means always includes three-tier system. Gram Panchayat, Block Panchayat, and District Panchayat. We have 2,55,540 Gram Panchayat and 6,824 Block Panchayat and 654 District Panchayat. This is the strength, the number of things. And also the very important things here you wanted to you have to note the important point is, see, at any given point of time, maybe different periods elections are happening, but at any given point of time, if you calculate all over India, including UTs also, where the Panchayat Raj systems in existing, nearly 31 lakh elected members will be there, approximately. So which includes Sarpanch, Pradhan, Panchayat President, and also the elected ward members and Jilla Parishad Council members, everybody actually. And equal number of around 30 lakh functionaries also working, government employees also working in the Panchayat level, in the form of Panchayat secretaries, data entry operator, Swachhata Karmachari, so many people are, MG Narega coordinators, what is the CRP we call, all the people who are under the payroll of Government of India system, nearly 30 lakh people there. At any point of time, if you see all over India, there are 60 lakh people are directly associated with Panchayat level. So that is the strength of the system actually, okay. And another important point here to note actually, please, among the total elected representatives, okay, I'm telling about the total elected representatives, nearly 14.39 lakh people are women representatives. This is also very unique in Indian system. No other country has this many elected women representatives associated with some governance system. I'm talking about Panchayat Raj as a local government. You know very well that after central government, state government, Panchayat Raj system, local government, and local government is the one, it is constitutionally giving 1/3 reservation for the woman. And for your kind information, nearly 20 states in India has given 50% reservation for women. So that is a very good thing to note, actually. You know, your own village, you can take example, if you see there, how many women representatives are participating as a ward member, as a sarpanch, as a pradhan, something. So that is a very clearly identify this thing. You can see in the ground level of what is the strength of these elected representatives here. So I included that 2,71,611 as a total PRS, which includes nearly 16,000 plus traditional local bodies in the northeastern states. So all put together under one system now, Panchayat Raj institutions. This is for your statistics actually. Friends, when you're talking about Panchayat as a third tier government, okay, these PRIs are existing. As per the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act, it is because of the two reasons actually. One is, it has to give the decentralization of power actually. The panchayat should act as a decentralized power, and also it also work for the development of the village. These are the two reasons why 73rd Amendment Act was enacted and it is implemented actually. So this is the two important reasons why Panchayat Raj institutions are existing in India actually. Let me quickly make through little detail about structure, then we'll go to the other aspects actually. So 73rd constitutional mandatory provision, I already told that it's a three-tier system, ZP, BP, ZP, and GP, okay? And elections conducted in every 5 years, everybody knows that. under the state election commissioners, the state election commission also in charge for the conducting elections for the local bodies, rural local bodies. We'll think like municipality they're conducting everywhere, even the state government what they're conducting, municipal, the panchayat elections also conducted by state election commissions actually. Okay, so normally district elections to all the seats in all levels, indirect elections for block panchayat and ZP presidents. And very another important thing under the constitution amendment is there should be a reservation for SCSTs. It is in the rotation basis. You know very well, the panchayat elections are happening in rotation basis. Every 5 years, you have to change this thing. Something you have to give preference for SCSTs, sometimes women, all the thing. And 1/3 reservation for women. This is also a mandatory in panchayat raj system. And for your information, I already told 20 states in India is giving 50% reservation. So that is giving another important perspective here. And another important core unit of the success, the not a success, the vibrancy of the panchayat raj system is Gram Sabha. So this is where people are directly participating and putting their opinion and expressing their views. No other system of governance in India, like parliament or the assembly in state, the public directly cannot go and give their opinion. Okay, only in the Gram Sabha, public can go directly as a voter into the Gram Sabha and express their views under the things, and things are executed actually. Otherwise, only we are sending our representatives. In case of assembly, we are sending our MLA as a representative who will talk on behalf of you. In case of central government, you are sending MP, member of parliament, as your representative. MP goes and talks on behalf of us actually. But in the Gram Sabha, the people's views and voices are heard directly into the things and minuted, and things are executed there actually. That is the crux of importance of panchayat raj system actually. I'm not going in detail into the other discretionary powers. And friends, if anybody imagine a panchayat raj system, normally you imagine you are coming from the village, gram panchayat, and I think they know that what panchayat, everybody is thinking that they will do what they'll do. Mainly they maintain the buildings, their drainage, provide water and electricity and other things. Okay, but that is not the only duty of panchayat raj. Unfortunately, majority of the panchayat are doing only those activity. But otherwise, as per the constitutional power, each panchayat as a mandate, they have to give three types of functions actually. Sorry. The panchayat has the powers and functions on three aspects. One is mandatory function, general function, and sectoral functions. Please understand that the mandatory function is nothing but what you are visibly normally seeing outside. The panchayat should provide electricity, water, road, and protection of public properties in the village, and it also collect license and penalties. These are the general things you should know that every panchayat is doing as a mandatory function. The general function, the very important aspect is panchayat also should execute all the development programs. Okay, for example, Swachh Bharat Mission, for example, 100 days wage employment, given job opportunity for MG Narega programs, and also we talked that road construction and the Prime Minister Awas Yojana, this thing, Gram Sadak Yojana, Awas Yojana, construction of houses, so implementation of some agriculture programs, all the scheme related programs, other than the Rural Development Ministry and other line ministries, panchayat should be the focal point, is the focal point to execute another thing. And apart from that, very important thing is panchayat has the power to implement schemes for economic development and social justice in respect to 29 subjects. This is very clearly defined in the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act. Okay, as per the constitution, the 29 subjects listed here, what I'll show you here, which includes, these are the things. I'm leaving this thing to your view just actually. So starting from agriculture, animal husbandry, minor irrigation, social forestry, rural housing, drinking water, cultural activity, family welfare, maintenance of community assets, education, library, name it, everything on rural development perspective. These are the 29 subjects identified, which is directly related to rural development, comes under the control of panchayat raj. But unfortunately, all the states, you should know that panchayats is a state subject. It's not a central subject. Every Panchayat Raj Act is actually evolved in the state government actually. They have the power to give, how much power can be given to panchayat and anything. Out of 29 subjects, some states have given 21, 26 subjects also. Some states have given only 6 subjects. Some states have given 12 to 13 subjects. So that means they devolved the power actually. They handed over the power to the panchayat, and budget also allotted to panchayat itself directly. They can do whatever in this area they wanted to. For example, Kerala has almost 21 sectors actually, which has the power to execute everything. Panchayat is a very powerful system there actually. Kerala, Karnataka, some extent, even I can say West Bengal, they are doing very deep into the things because there are a lot of very strong power has given to the Panchayat, not on the other states. So other states are slowly gaining importance. Influence of other, what is the district and state level things are more in the other states actually. But some of the states are doing really wonderful in Panchayat level because these powers are given to them in a large area. And I told already that we should understand one important thing actually as a Grama Sabha. Okay. So the importance and the real basic unit of governance in the Panchayat Raj system is Grama Sabha. It consists of all persons above 18 years. If you are a water member, you have the water list in the Gram Panchayat, you have the right to participate in Gram Sabha and you can talk whatever you want to say there and give your opinion actually. Okay. Normally Gram Sabha is convened 2 to 6.
Sir, you have muted yourself. Kathirasan, sir. Hello, sir. You have muted.
No. Am I audible, madam, now?
Yeah, now you are audible, sir.
I'm not muting. Somebody is doing there, actually.
Okay.
I'm not touching, ma'am. Please ask them. Okay, I'm checking. Okay.
Sure.
If anything is there, please.
Yeah, I will intervene, sir, definitely. Okay. Please continue, sir. Yeah.
So I told that the understanding the Grama Sabha, when you talk about the rural development perspective, this thing, Grama Sabha is becoming a very important key democratic process. Please understand that rural development does not happen overnight by schemes or anything, nothing. Until unless people's participation is not there, we cannot expect any rural development. Any village, if you take any village in India, maybe Maharashtra something, Karnataka and Telangana here, so many villages in Karimnagar or Warangal we are seeing, some beautiful developed villages we go and visit also as a model village. Whatever model village kind, if you see and see, analyze very clearly, definitely you can observe one point very clearly, the people's participation. The people should participate and involve in the development process. Otherwise, if the people participation is not happening, that never going to be a developed village actually. So this is our very strong opinion from our thing, same thing. So our ultimate aim of whole department institutions working in the rural development area is how much we can ensure maximum people's participation in the development process. Like in the process of Grama Sabha, in the meetings, Ward Sabha and other things. Without people's participation, they cannot understand the problems and take it further to the solution actually. If only the Panchayat Sarpanch and members do something, it never going to be a partial development actually. It never going to be a full-fledged development. So Grama Sabha becomes a very core component of in the development process actually. Okay. So that you should very clearly understand and approve actually. So what does Grama Sabha does? I think it approves the plans and programs as per the mandatory things. Every plan, every year, the Gram Panchayat are mandated to make plan and Grama Sabha approves this thing actually. And that also approves the annual budget. And very important thing is Grama Sabha, through Grama Sabha, the right beneficiaries and the beneficial public or the persons in the village should be identified. It is not only the Sarpanch or Ward members randomly select people. It should not be there. It should be selected through Grama Sabha only. Then only the real, what is that, participatory things are something and democratic process is involved actually. Okay, I'm not going into other part actually. So apart from the general things I told, the Panchayat Raj system, the three-tier system and other thing like that, there are some special category in the areas. We call it as fifth schedule areas and sixth schedule area. So in the tribal areas, if you see that governance in tribal areas, you should know that the Panchayat Raj system exists like this actually. We call it as, these are the states called under PESA states. PESA means Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act. Many scholars who are studying in the rural development and tribal affairs related things, they know very well actually the importance of Panchayat extension to scheduled areas, where 10 states have been listed under Schedule 5. Okay, Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Himachal Pradesh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Odisha, Rajasthan and Telangana. These are the 10 states comes under PESA. Please understand that not whole this whole state is not comes under PESA, selected districts actually. Okay. Selected districts in that particular state comes under PESA actually. Some states, all districts comes under PESA. So these are the area where really the tribal population is more and demarcated under tribal area actually. So they have a special power in the panchayat actually. In the panchayat raj system, these people have the special power. Panchayat as a unit, they cannot make any decisions. Every decision has to be made only through Gram Sabha. A small decision, if the particular panchayat in the Pesa area they want to make, they have to go to the Gram Sabha and make the decision actually. So like that, we have some special category in the 6 scheduled areas, in the tribal areas, particularly in the northeastern states. Okay, in the 6 scheduled areas are governed by autonomous district councils and village councils. There are 2 bodies, like our Zilla Parishad, or what we call it as Jilla Parishad here, or district panchayat management, chairman and everything. They have special category that including 20-25 villages or whole district, they'll have a autonomous district councils and village councils. Those people, which is coming traditionally, it is managed by a particular community head is managing this thing actually. So these ADCs and BCs are very important part of 6 schedule area actually. The 4 states comes under 6 schedule area includes Assam, part of Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. These 4 states actually. You should understand that the 6 schedule area questions actually. Okay, now friends, I'll come just quickly to the things and the development perspective something. Panchayat, what the panchayat has to pay, has to do, and what are the mandatory role of the panchayat in perspective to rural development actually. So I'm bringing here the Constitutional Amendment Act 243G, okay, where it's very clearly says that constitution provisions very clearly says that there are 2 things in the bottom you can see there. 2 mandatory works of the panchayat raj, okay, which is a very, very much important actually. Preparation of plans, implementation of schemes. These 2 are very important. These things, when I'm talking about preparation of plans and implementation of schemes, we are going for a local planning. So all the panchayat in India, government of in India, I told already 2,55,000 plus gram panchayat and 2,70,000 plus total panchayats, they have to mandatorily prepare plan, not a 5-year plan, it's an annual plan. So in case of gram panchayat level, I will talk, they have to compulsorily prepare gram panchayat development plan. For what purpose? It is to diagnose the local problems and rational application of resources. Panchayat should understand what is their power, monetary power, manpower, resources, and what are the issues in their own village. And accordingly, understanding the local problem, they have to prepare a plan. So that plan is called GPDP. So this is a very important aspect. It's the government of India is focusing and spending a lot of money for this exercise. So every Gram Panchayat, every year during the month of October, November, December, this Gram Panchayat development plan is mandatory actually. Okay. So let us see what is a GPDP actually. So when I'm talking about Gram Panchayat Development Plan as a mandatory thing, you should understand what is the importance of GPDP. So GPDP is a comprehensive plan for all 29 subjects. Every panchayat, all joining together, they have to prepare this plan. So covering all the 29 subjects, they should not neglect any other social development aspects. They should not plan only for infrastructure, making a building, making a bus shed, or to the some unwanted buildings, which is not at all used forever. They have to plan including all aspects of development, right from the socio-economic development, including women development, child development, drinking water, or some cultural issues, everything. So we can bring it any aspects in thing 29 subject actually. The plan should consist of all the 29 subject. And there is a very big push from the government of India, particularly Ministry of Panchayat Raj and Rural Development, which is now agreed by other line ministers. No? Every village in India, every Gram Panchayat in India should prepare only one plan, and that should be GPDP. They should not have a parallel plan. Whatever other plan they are preparing, that becomes a part of this plan document. So only Panchayat should have a plan that is called GPDP. This GPDP should contain other line department plans as an additional thing. So now there is a one village, one plan concept, that is GPDP. Okay, and it should be based on the local needs. It should match with the resources of the availability. We cannot plan in air without understanding the real problems and how much money we are going to get from the government, how much money from the state government is giving, how much people are supporting anything. So it should be very reasonable and rational. The rationality is very, very important here. So without understanding the people needs, the importance of people's requirement, we should not make any plan actually. So that is a very fulcrum of, and it should be very a participatory approach actually. So that is a very important aspect of DPDP planning. Friends, I'm not going in detail actually. These are the general guidelines in which I'm sharing one guideline also later to Madam. Madam will share to all the participants. It is available in the public domain also. Normally in the GPDP is prepared based on, these are the areas where GPDP is prepared. Economic development, human development, social development, including SDGs. Okay, localization of SDGs, public service delivery, skill building, spatial planning, ICT infrastructure, ICT infra, everything. These are the key focus areas where plan exercise is done. Friends, you can see this particular guidelines, which gives you a total A to Z of this GPDP. How a panchayat should prepare the GPDP, what purpose it's preparing, what are the steps involved in preparing. Everything you can see from the this particular guidelines, which is available online. Just type GPDP guidelines, Ministry of Panchayat Raj, you will get it actually. So in the planning process, every year I told from the month of October to December, we are entertaining this particular this thing. There is an exercise, cycle of exercise with 8 to 9 activities happening. Starting from the top, this is called plan cycle for preparation of GPDP. GPDP plan cycle we call. So first formation of a group in the village. A set up group is formed. We call them Gram Panchayat Project Facilitation Team. So this Gram Panchayat Project Facilitation Team is identified in the Gram Sabha in the month of October first week. And that 3 months, that team will make the total plan involving public PRE exercise like participatory rural appraisal, collection of data, and they all sit together and make analysis of data, listening exercise. Finally, draft plan is made. Finally, again, it is get approved in the Gram Sabha in the month of December or January. Then finally, it is uploaded into the national level, and that same plan is utilized for something. Please understand that the plan for 2021-22 is going to be prepared from this October. You have to understand that. So 1 year prior to the plan, this thing, the planning is done 1 year prior to the activity starts actually. The plan prepared this year will come to existence to the 1st April of next year actually. So in that context, national level, this is becoming a very important talk, and things are happening. So if I go very detailed into that, it will take time. So I'll give you glimpses only something. For the past 2 years, this is the third year we are entering, Government of India giving the importance of GPDP. Why GPDP is so important in the rural development perspective, to come to a common understanding, one village, one plan concept. There is a movement is happening national level, which is supported by NIRDPR also. Our department is supporting Ministry of Panchayat Raj and Ministry of Rural Development. Combinedly, we are doing this exercise. That's called Sabki Yojana Sabka Vikas. Okay, this is a people's plan movement actually. People's plan campaign for GPDP. So we are making every Gram Panchayat, they prepare a quality GPDP and proper GPDP. So with that idea only, this exercise is happening every year from 2nd October to 31st December. So every year, this year also it's going to start the 2nd October, but this year they extended up to January, 31st January. This is very unique, this year because of the corona, this thing actually. So this is very interesting exercise. Everywhere the panchayat are come together, we go to the villages and we interact with the people, and also we go to the state level and conduct programs. Everything is happening like a mela for this campaign, people's plan campaign. You want to understand what is happening in every village during this period, the GPDP, how the plan is prepared, who are the people are participating, and what are the things that who are the real line departmental people are coming to the Gram Sabha, how the plan is prepared, and every details, A to Z details with the photographs, you will get from this website actually. In the national, you can just drill down to your state, district, block, and Gram Panchayat. Then you will get the details. This is called gpdp.nic.in. So I am giving this information to you. So once if you go to the individual page of a particular village, it looks like this. So every Gram Panchayat detail is available in this format of who is the sarpanch, who is the panchayat secretary, what are the data collected, what is the plan details, everything will be there. Who are the people participated in the meeting? How the planning exercise is done. So it's very interesting exercise and a very vibrant exercise happening in the village during the period actually. Friends, before closing in 2 minutes, this thing, I'll just inform one important thing actually. See, we always say that, believe that Panchayat Raj system means it is corrupted, they're not doing anything, and that it's not like that actually. So we cannot say, okay, take a generalized statement that Panchayat are not doing anything. Now the things are changing very drastically. Last 5 years, things are moved in a different perspective, and panchayat are getting a lot of support and a lot of monitoring is happening there, and they are really vibrant. There is no dearth of money. Again, I'm using the word, the central government, state government support is very huge for panchayat these days, and in the form of 15th finance commission, huge money is given directly to the panchayat. Earlier, it was not the scenario. There was some big share was for a district and block, and last 14th finance commission period, 100% all the fund is given to panchayat account directly. When you can see the difference in the last three planning period, the finance commission, this thing, last three thing, year one, year two, year three, four, 5 years in the last three finance commission things I compared here. maybe I am saying that about 2015 to 2020, it is a huge, you can see the difference in the 14th Finance Commission, the money difference, almost 60,000 plus crores in every last year. It was 60,000 crores spent for the Panchayat. It is directly deposited into the account of the Panchayat. So you can see, like, compared to last year, it was only 18,000 in the 5 years before. But last year, the 15th Finance Commission is given 60,000 plus and 14th Finance Commission. And this is the share actually of the 14th Finance Commission. You can see that every year, last 4 years, 5 years, how much money has been spent on Panchayat. Starting from 21,000, then 33,000, again 39. Last year, it was 60,000 crores. Total, it is 2 lakh crore money has been spent on Panchayats the last 5 years. And a very important thing is now, 15th Finance Commission has started the activities in, what is that, 1 month before they announced, 4 months before, from April it started. In this, only 1 year they announced the money. Next 4 years, they are going to announce the money. In this amount, there are 60,000 plus crores have been allotted for the PRIs, local bodies, this year. So this is, you should understand. So there is a great support is there for Panchayats, and they can utilize properly for the rural urban perspective. Definitely, we can see a sea of change actually. So I'm not going in detail about how the money is spent and other thing like that. This year, understanding the importance of rural development perspective and other thing, Government of India made the Finance Commission made some strict rules that whatever money the panchayats are getting, all the three tiers, they have to spend 50% freely. That means untied funds, 50% is tied. Means 50% spent they can use for the maintenance of panchayat and other activities. 50% they have to go only for these three works. Sanitation and maintenance of ODF, drinking water and rainwater harvesting. Please understand that these are very much required items, this thing, and every village really needs this improvement. So keeping in mind, the three things are made mandatory now. When they're planning GPDP, 50% of their total resources. I'm coming back to now. I'm closing this thing. This is the last slide. I think I'm giving these things. What are the activity they have to do? The other aspects, something. So I'll stop here. And you get a lot of information about all this Panchayat Raj system and other things in our NIRTPR website. We have a learning portal, e-learning portal called Gram Swaraj. In that, you please go through the courses related to the what we are doing and what type of training we are offering to the Panchayat Raj Institution and other things. I'm stopping here, give you a very general perspective about Panchayat Raj system and other things. Thank you here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Despite having a busy schedule, you managed some time. Sir, I request you to kindly take few questions.
Yeah, why not? No
problem. Posted by the participants. Mr. Bhaskar Gogoi, he has a question that how PISA is utilized in particular states?
Yeah, this is a very, very generic question actually. But unfortunately, the PISA is really a very strong act and other thing like that. Except Maharashtra. They come out with a very beautiful, very strong PISA Act. Other states are still struggling to come out with a very strong. Every state has the, all the 10 states has the PISA Act actually. Maharashtra is very systematically utilizing this act and giving power to the Punjab. But other states are slowly coming forward actually. Chhattisgarh is far better. They are doing very good this thing at least. And it is again the problem is the how much strongly the state governments are enacting this thing. So it depends on that. If state government is not willing to give the full power to the tribal areas, this thing, it becomes the act becomes, what is that, unutilized on this thing. This is only general statement I would like to say at this moment. Actually. So state to state, it differs. Okay, thank you. Next question.
Sir, another question by Mr. Sharma is, what are the two major differences you have seen with the introduction of ICT in Gram Panchayat functioning?
Yeah. So please understand that actually the e-panchayat, the monitoring the panchayat through ICT was almost started 9 years before. Okay, but in a very small level, 2015 onwards they are trying, but it's not in the 100% this thing. It definitely brought, after the last 2 years, what I am observing working with the e-panchayat concept, it definitely brings a lot of transparency. You can see that now, you can see last year data if you see from the e-Gram Swaraj portal and other thing. We know that for what purpose the panchayat is spent, how much money is spent, they cannot misutilize because PFMS is linked here. Every rupee spent is accounted here. And we can see that where the wrong planning they're doing and whether the panchayats are doing right planning or anything, really in fingertip, we can get the ministry and other things. And this gives you a lot of insight for us to make the proper policy and everything. But unfortunately, nearly 50% of the panchayat, they're not accessing the, they don't have access to proper internet and other thing. The every data update is happening only in mandal or into the district level. So that is unfortunate thing, but slowly it is increasing. Last 2 years, definitely we are seeing a lot of data is flowing, more accurate data is flowing to the national level. So that is where IT is playing one thing. Now, even we are doing a lot of activities through mobile apps and live classes and everything. Panchayat are very, thanks to the mobile revolution, it is making a lot of impact actually. Okay.
Sir, there is also questions on like what is the role of MPTCS and ZPTCS in Panchayati Raj system? Like how their roles have evolved?
Definitely as per the constitutional things, they have a different role. But unfortunately, what happened last 14th Finance Commission period, there is no fund allotted to MPTC and ZPTC. So they are just like a honorary post. They are saying that they are not given any money power. Every money 100% was sent to only Panchayat. But understanding their important role, because they are also very important. Suppose, for example, a mandal ZPTC or ZPTC or mandal level, when they have a common planning, like bringing a one water grid or something, I think their role is very important. It not all the plan should be planned only in panchayat. Combining 4 or 5 panchayat also, we can make plan. That can be possible only through Zilla Parishad level or mandal level. So their role is very important. Understanding their role back, 15th Finance Commission is giving more importance. 70% fund is allotted to Gram Panchayat. 30% is split into district and block panchayat. That means 15% they can go to district, 15% to mandal, like that. So they have to involve in the planning process, and they are the really the very important bridge between the district administration and the Gram Panchayat. So that way their role is very, very important. So they cannot neglect their role actually.
Okay, sir. I would invite Mr. Somav Bhattarji. You have raised your hand. If you have any question, please quickly.
Please.
Put across. Sir has to leave.
Yeah.
Mr. Somav Bhattacharji.
Yeah, please.
What is the role of development in Gram Sadak Yojana or something? Or Jal Jeevan Mission? What is the basic need?
Now, can you repeat, little louder, Mr.
What, little louder, sir. What is the role of?
Hello.
What is the Please. Role of panchayat and rural development? Hello. What is the role of panchayat and rural development in case of Gram Sadak Yojana or Jal Jeevan Mission?
Acha, okay. Both actually. See, I already told no, sir. Actually, under the they have to identify the requirement actually. The panchayat have to identify the requirement, give it to the rural development ministry. Okay, and Jal Jeevan Mission also. The beneficiary identification is from panchayat, and also the execution is under the control of panchayat. Please understand that when they're making the plan, they should say that what is the requirement, and I think accordingly the mission and schemes has to be implemented. For example, there is a requirement of road from one hamlet to other thing. Panchayat decides and makes a decision in the Gram Sabha. Without taking the panchayat decision in the Gram Sabha and minuting, government cannot implement that particular road actually. It has to go to the next level, and it is included in the district level planning. So that way, panchayat plays a major role in identifying the requirement and also the execution, both level. So this is in the two aspect also. In Jal Jeevan Mission, definitely 100% the panchayat involvement is directly there with that ministry actually. Okay. Is it fine?
Yes, sir. Sir, I think this one last question, and then we will let you go. What is your personal experience on implementation of rural development programs in villages?
Ma'am, actually, we are observing in the perspective of through panchayat, everything actually. Okay, because you know that it is a lifeline, the rural development schemes like MG Narega and other thing like that. It's a lifeline for many things like pension schemes and other things. So and the rural development schemes, certain schemes are really created very good impact. Maybe certain schemes are not taken very well because of through some implementation problems. If the panchayat leadership is very good, they are work very closely with public, these schemes are really 100% achieve the benefit. For example, I can give a lot of example in Assam, West Bengal, or here in Telangana itself something. During the lockdown period, wherever the come from, the migrant people have come back and they're not able to go back, and they're not getting any job, anything. Many panchayats have taken a decision that they given work are in advance, they paid the money through the schemes and given work to them preference, actually the 100 days wage employment, this thing, and they got real benefit. Actually they utilized that fund very effectively, and they given importance to that the job opportunity for this thing like that. So the schemes are really good. Every scheme is really good. Until unless the panchayat takes it very seriously, understanding the people's requirement, it is implemented in a participatory manner, the schemes will fail. Otherwise, if they implement the schemes, it will be a failure. If they really involve and utilize the importance of the scheme and everything, this really created a lot of impact in the gram panchayat. We have a lot of examples to say in many states. That is my opinion, actually. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Actually, there is one more question if you have time.
Okay, sir.
Thank you so much. I'll post this question to your email.
Yeah, please.
And once you respond, I will get back to participants.
Thank you all. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir, for being with us.
Thank you so much, sir.
Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
Dear participants, we have with us another very, very distinguished and senior sociologist, very well known in India, Professor Sanjay Singhji, who is convener of Research Committee on Adivasi and Tribal Studies, Indian Sociological Society, and he is basically from Ram Manohar Lohia Law University, Lucknow. Professor Sanjay Singh has a teaching experience of more than 2 decades, and his areas of specialization are Indian sociology, sociology of politics, sociology of law, rural studies, and democratic decentralization. He has organized several academic activities, seminars, and workshops, and he has published on diversified topics, including women gram pradhans and village governance, a journey from 1995 to 2010, which was published in the year 2013. He has also published on reading Lohia, perspective of the youth, and debating Lohia, a reader. He has been associated with number of research projects. Some of the important ones are democratic decentralization and gender, legal impact assessment, and environment and social impact assessment, which were funded by ICSSR New Delhi and Government of Uttar Pradesh. He has also extended consultancies to different organizations. Friends, this is a golden opportunity for us to interact with Professor Sanjay Singh and listen to him, especially now that the central government has come up with new environment impact assessment plan, which is widely being debated. So in this context, on behalf of Department of Sociology, I extend a very, very warm welcome to Professor Sanjay Singh ji. And I hope your interaction, your presence will show us the way in terms of rural and tribal development in India. Welcome, Professor Singh, and over to you now.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I'm audible to you?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. You are clear.
So good.
Yeah.
I'm very thankful to the organizers, particularly Dr. Vinita Pandey, along with Nizam College, Hyderabad. Nizam College Hyderabad do have a long history. It's a prestigious institute of Hyderabad. So the moment they requested me to participate in this webinar, I consented to their demand, since they said that I'm the convener of Adivasis and Tribal Studies of Indian Sociological Society. And the topic they have chosen for the discussion was tribal and rural development. So that created in me an interest to explore the nomenclature of my research committee. When I've taken over as the convener of the RC7, that is Adivasis and Tribal Study at present, the name of the committee was Rural, Peasant, and Tribal Communities. Meaning thereby, there was no distinction made between rural, peasant and tribal, and all these communities, in fact, they were taken together in that research committee. But later on, Indian Sociological Society constituted a committee to look into the restructuring of different research committees. And that whole affair, they made two separate research committees, and the Adivasis and Tribal Studies become a independent one from rural and peasant society. So looking into the relationship between the peasant and the tribal, I have taken the help of many, particularly I'm very thankful to those individuals. I would like to take their names, Professor Andre Bete, Professor Vinay Shirvastava, Professor Sukant Chaudhary, Professor H.S. Saxena, Professor A.K. Verma. I have taken their work, and from their work, in fact, I try to make my presentation. So when I gone through their works, in fact, the first one where I was taking recourse to Professor Bete, and he's recognizing that the historian and economist, they did not make any differentiation between tribal and the peasant communities, but sociologists do make later on. And why there was the reason. He said that Robert Redfield, who is known for his studies in the rural community, he has taken recourse to the differentiation where he's differentiating between tribes, peasant, and urban society. But the differences between tribes and peasant in India is in general are very less, meaning thereby if you try to understand who tribe is and who is peasant, who is from rural India, it becomes all more difficult. And no doubt a serious thinking and effort was done. It was not done, in fact, to define tribe, and that's why when it comes to finding out which particular communities, which particular groups they are tribe, it becomes all more difficult every time. And these difficulties perceived in most of these states. So during the British time period, in fact, if you take, it's not the tribes, they are existing from that particular time period. They are existing in India since time immemorial. But during the British time period, the intervention from the side of the government was there. And that has created number of issues, number of problems. And these issues and problems along, they have taken recourse to how to take up this definition of tribe. And if I take the different senses, then the major individuals I have taken recourse to, in fact, what they say, the substantial number of tribal people are peasant today. And this is because we no longer have tribes in their pure state, but tribes in transition, meaning thereby what they are saying, if you take the tribal groups of the central India and the down south, what you are getting that most of the tribal population groups, they are the peasant, they are all involved in the agricultural activities. Not only I'm talking about this particular area, other areas also, the distinction is very difficult for us to make. And that's why when we are talking about this distinction, later on, we are deciding, or we are coming on to a point that we say that no, more or the less tribal and peasant, they are more or the less the part and parcel of the same background, same similar, in fact, characteristic features, they are more or the less the same. And that's why no distinction should be made. This one. Now, when we take this premises, then we are taking together rural and tribal development together, meaning thereby Professor earlier who has talked about a number of things about rural development. In fact, they are already incorporated when it comes to the tribal development. So the first attempt in during the British time period, it was 1891. G.A. Baines, the commissioner of census, in fact, classified the castes according to their traditional occupation. and under the category of agricultural and pastoral caste, he formed a subheading called Forest Tribe. So for the first time, you are getting a name for them. In 1901 census, what you are getting, that name is transformed to enemies. Again, 1911 census, this tribal enemies. And then in 1921, they are called as Hill and Forest Tribe. In 1931, they are called as Primitive Tribe. And Government of India Act 1935, giving another caption to them, they are the Backward Tribes. In 1941, they are getting the caption as Tribe. And after adoption of Constitution, certain tribes have been specified as Scheduled Tribe, and it is these tribes who get the privileges, and those who couldn't get the place there in that schedule, they are not getting the privileges of the Scheduled Tribe. But one thing that is very important to take note of, the Constitution neither defines nor lay down any condition, in fact, as far as the Scheduled Tribes are concerned. So it's not, the Constitution is not defining them, but Constitution is saying you put them into that particular schedule, and from there, they are deriving number of good things, number of good privileges. So the 1950 Constitutional Amendment Order with the full list of Scheduled Tribes recognized the very large list based on the list of the backward tribes prepared by the Government of India Act 1935. So number of tribal groups, in fact, they were all included in that. Article 366, 25 of the Constitution defines Scheduled Tribes as Scheduled Tribe means such tribes or tribal communities or parts of the group within such tribes or tribal communities as are deemed under Article 342 to the Scheduled Tribes for the purposes of the Constitution, meaning thereby, with Article 342, in fact, that will tell you about. And in fact, this is all number of committees, number of debates were there regarding that. But still, no clear picture is there with us. And in fact, Backward Caste Commission, they're all having their own, in fact, Kaka Kalilkar Commission appointed by the president under Article 342 argued that they led exclusive existence. They are not fully assimilated in the main body of the people. Scheduled tribe may belong to any little number of things. In fact, they were all talked about. But if we take not very clear since 19, if you take their position there in the schedule, then it's 1930 census when G.H. Hutton was the commissioner. And for the first time, the tribe is distinguished from caste. For the first time, and the list in the Constitution is also the contribution of this census. When I'm saying that they were all taken recourse to, they hear the issue distinction between caste and tribe gained prominence. Tribe came to be more religious than caste. In fact, that distinction was made. But later on, a number of things happened, and it's very difficult, in fact. At present also, number of issues they are there with reference to their identification and they're putting there in a particular list. Although things are improving a bit, but still problems are there. And in Constituent Assembly, just when the schedule was all in the process of preparation, two members, member Mr. Jaipal Singh and one more member was there who said we should have a name Adivasis for these communities, but Dr. Ambedkar, who was having a legal background, he said, no, if you are taking this word as a community name for them, maybe later on it will create certain problems because we cannot legally define them. And that's why we need to have a legal frame to understand at least who these individuals are, meaning thereby their inclusion to the, what you call it as the schedule, their identity that is established by the Constitution left a major population group out of this list. I'll come to the case of Uttar Pradesh later on of my discussion. In fact, there we discussed that what are the important problems and issues they were there all along, in fact, with reference to the scheduled tribe in India. And after independence, we have initiated with the developmental process. And that particular developmental process, in fact, how it took off is important. I'll take the help of Barrington Moore's book, Social Origin of Dictatorship and Democracy, where he argues that there are three main routes to the modern world. One, he says, by a bourgeois revolution, by a fascist revolution, and third, by a peasant revolution. And then after a pause, he is talking about that, yes, there is also a fourth route represented by development of India since independence, meaning thereby a very different kind of process we have adopted, we have taken a recourse to. There are a number of things are going on, and this developmental parallel you won't be having anywhere in the world. And that's what exactly he is indicating towards. So what are the developmental debates, and how this debate is particularly affecting tribes, this is important to say. When you take one very important individual warrior, Alwyn, a missionary, a British, who is working with the tribes, particularly with the central India tribal groups, later on, northeastern part of the India. And he is dedicating his life to the tribal studies. So he is one important individual who is having his philosophy, who is having his viewpoints regarding development of the tribal groups. And he is taking an isolationist perspective approach, and counter to him, there are others. For example, Professor G.S. Gourier and others, they are there. And they have taken the course to what you call it as assimilationists. They try to have the assimilation of these tribal groups into the mainstream. And in between these two groups, in order to moderate that, Prime Minister Nehru is there, and who is saying that, no, you cannot maintain isolation, you cannot assimilate together. And that's why you need to have a middle path. And that's the middle path of integration. And on 9th October 1958, the date of Nehru's foreword to the second edition of the Philosophy of NEPHA, there are five important points, in fact. And in the popular parlance, we say the Panchashil for the tribal population group. And what these Panchashil are: one, people should develop along the lines of their genius, and we should avoid imposing anything on them. We should try to encourage in every way their own traditional art and culture, meaning thereby a policy of non-interference should be there, and whatever interference has to be done, that has to be very careful. Tribal rights in land and forest should be protected. This is important. Still, this particular point is creating certain number of problems for us. Third, we should try to train and build up a team of their own people to do the work of the administration and development. Some technical personnel from outside will no doubt be needed, especially in the beginning, but we should avoid introducing too many outsiders into the tribal territory. There's another very important artist: you do not disturb them, you just develop their capacity building, and the moment the things are all done, we shouldn't interfere with their cultural processes, with their indigenous system, with their indigenous knowledge, with their indigenous medicinal practice. A number of things are there. Fourth, we should not over-administer these areas or overwhelm them with number of projects, with number of schemes. We should rather work through and not in rivalry to their own socio and cultural institutions. In fact, we shouldn't have that competition with them, that their lifestyle is better, ours is better, and that debate is altogether a difficult one. So in whatever in fact circumstances they are, you try to improve, but don't try to disturb. That's the main motto. and the faith, we should judge results not by the statistics or the amount of money spent, but by the quality of human character that is evolved. That is important. In fact, this is not the numbers. We go by GDP, we go by numbers, we go by number of economic indicators. But what you say is, no, this is not going to work for the community. At least we should improve their quality of life. And so these five points, they are all very important. But as usual, there are others to oppose that. And the first one, I'm teaching in the Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University, and the Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia is the first person, in fact, to oppose to this whole policy frame. And he is the first person who tried to enter into the territory of Northeast, and where at the Jarampur outpost, second time when he tried to enter into that, he was arrested in spite of the fact that governor and others, they were saying they are going to issue you the permit. But he said, why I should need a permit to move on from one place to another place in India? This is a very valid point he was saying. And he was arrested. So you can you understand, take this point, leader of the stretcher of Lohia was arrested. He was trying to enter into a particular area, a tribal area, which was not open to all. So that was the frame, in fact, and that's why the things were all criticized. Professor Guri was there. He said Elvin is isolationist and a no changer, a revivalist. And he later on said that the tribes are the backward Hindus, meaning thereby a religious connotation was all imposed upon the tribes. Things were all going on, in fact. And then from here, we can take up two important policy frames of Nehru. At one policy frame, what Nehru says, to quote, I'm not at all sure which way of living is better, ours or theirs, with reference to tribe he's talking about. But in some way, I'm quite certain theirs is better. A great deal of things can be learned from their culture. So what he's saying is the tribal living system is much, much better than ours, and we should learn from them. But at the same time, after independence, the industrial policy frame that the Nehruvian government has taken recourse to, where he was talking about the temples of modern India, big industries, big steel plants, and all that, they seems to be in contradiction to one another. Or that simple life, along with this complex industrial development, which led to number of problems for the tribal population group, it was difficult. In fact, it was to a certain extent a contradiction in the Nehruvian policy frame. Then after number of five-year plans, in fact, Prime Minister Nehru initiated with the five-year plans, and number of things were all done for the welfare of the tribal and the scheduled areas, PIPCAS. In fact, the first five-year plan talks about welfare and development of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Second five-year plan, 43 special multi-purpose tribal blocks were created and for the welfare of the tribes. In the fourth five-year plan, you are getting 6 pilot projects in the state of Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, MP, Odisha, separate tribal development agencies, in fact, and the fifth tribal sub-plan to direct benefit to the scheduled tribe, and so forth, number of schemes were launched. Not only that, constitution do provide them with certain promises, promotion of educational, economic interest, protection from the social injustice and other forms of exploitation, special representation in Lok Sabha and the state assemblies. Not only that, a special provision for the fifth and the sixth scheduled areas that already professor has talked about, and then the prevention of Civil Rights Act 1955, and then after scheduled tribe prevention of atrocities Act 1989 that was revised in 2014-15. They were all there. Tribe Fed was established in 1987. for the welfare of the tribal people, so that whatever produce they are getting from the forest, at least they get the minimum support price for that. They get particular market for that. So the things were all going on. But the question is, still a number of things were done. Good policy formulations were there. Good intention on the part of the Prime Minister Nehru was there, because the 5 points, in fact, they are clearly making the things all very clear to us. What's the reason why we still talk about the tribes? They lag behind in development, and this is important. For that, we need to enter into what you call it as the challenges of development. And these challenges, they are multi-faceted challenges. If you remember, a committee was constituted in 2013 for what you call it as for the tribal state, to study the status of the tribes, their problems, their issues, and that particular committee was named after the chairman's name, that is Virginius Kaka. Kaka Committee 2013 was constituted in 2014. It has submitted its report. Kaka Committee talks about number of challenges for this tribal population group. And what are the important challenges this committee talks about? Tribes legal and administrative framework, in fact, is talking about the administration of the fifth and sixth scheduled areas. Where are the problems? Then role of the governor is very important. He's providing certain inputs as to how the office of the governor may take a number of steps for the governance of the tribal population group. And then the tribal advisory council, how this tribal advisory council is going to work. And very important thing is recommending that at least 50% of the members of the tribal advisory council should be scheduled tribes, so that at least they can be sympathetic towards the development of their community members. Second important challenge is livelihood and employment status. This is also very important in comparison to other major societal groups in India. The tribes are far lag in that whole affair. So he's recommending for the organic farming there in their particular area. Not only that, water conservation should be there, because now majority of the tribal population group, in fact, they are depending upon agriculture and the forest activities. Agro-based training institutes should be established. And for the particularly vulnerable tribal groups, communities, in fact, the special attention has to be paid. Then he's talking about the third important challenge is the challenge of education. The recommendation from his side is the education should be contextual. And what he says, whatever programs and policies of the government was there with reference to education, they could not penetrate properly there in the tribal areas. So a need is there. And the local area approach should be there. Local language should be promoted. And the Eklavya schools should be established more. And then national, the present new education policy in 2020, in fact, though it's not very vocal about the needs of the tribal population group, but the moment it will unfold itself, maybe there are a number of good things as far as the tribal population group is concerned, we hope. So then health is another important issue. So whatever sustainable development goals, they are there with reference to that, Millennium Development Goals, which are there. The traditional medicine has to be promoted, and whatever traditional knowledge with reference to tribal is there, we should protect them, and we should try to share it with the others. Not only that, certain important measures should be taken up for the health perspective of the tribal population group, because on the different indicators of health, they are lag behind. Then another very important point that's talking about the land alienation, displacement, and forced migration. The recommendation of the committee is that the very less displacement should be there. And if it is very essential, then and then only we should take recourse to displacement. Then the Land Acquisition Act 2013 is a good step, or they say, but it need to be more comprehensive, and certain improvements, if they are there in that, maybe it's going to help the tribals more. Then there are legal and constitutional issues, for example, PESA, Forest Rights Act, position of women there in that, and then the Scheduled Tribe, Scheduled Caste Prevention of Atrocities Act, how they are going to be restructured, or they are going to be more effective. Number of good things are there in these particular laws, but how these particular laws, they are not going to work properly. And then delivery of public goods and services is important. And for that, the committee recommends for tribal research institutes in these particular areas. And then ministry, another important, the number of institutes which are already existing with reference to tribal research, they should be under the guidance of Ministry of Tribal Affairs instead of Ministry of Culture. So number of things, in fact, Kaka committee talks about, and it's all very comprehensive. All the issues, they are very, very important, and they affect not only tribes, they affect all, but particularly tribal population. They are affected, no doubt about that, and the things has to be done, in fact, to take them out. For example, if you take certain statistics, then whatever number of displacement that occurred after independence, in fact, if you take that, nearly 40% of the displacements, they were there with reference to the tribal population. Not only that, if I take Uttar Pradesh as a good example, if I quote Paul Grass, in one of a particular district, due to one particular project, a population group was displaced number of times. And as a result of that, the existence of that population group is no more visible. This is the extent of displacement, and who they are. They are mostly the tribal and the vulnerable communities who don't have any voice, or who don't have any political assertion on their part. And that's why they are very easy prey to this whole drama of development. Then, no doubt, UN Declaration on Human Rights talks about development is a comprehensive economic, social, and cultural process, which aims at the constant improvement of well-being of the entire population and all individuals on the basis of their active, free, and meaningful participation in development and the fair distribution of benefits resulting therefrom. This all, it's looking good, but the moment I'll just discuss you with the Uttar Pradesh case, I think the things seems to be altogether a different one. How that will take that then? I always say post 90s, number of good things happened, and number of good things happened with reference to the tribal societies also. International Labour Organization, they are talking about displacement of the tribes, and it's all the tribes along with the community may be displaced, provided they are settled in a much, much better place in comparison to what they have inhabited. But this is all there in the papers. And UN Declaration on the Rights of the Indigenous People 2007 also talks about our tribal rights and the resources. So number of good enactments, they are there at the global level. And due to that developments, a certain number of good developments, they are there on the part of our system also. I will discuss it. But one and two developments, in fact, with reference to the tribal population, for example, with reference to education scheme is Eklavya School. That fascinated me. Why that fascinated me? Because that particular residential school is on the model of Navodaya schools, and the nearly 248 schools they have established, 219 schools they are functional, and nearly 65,000 students they are studying there. This is important because on each and every student, the total investment is 1,09,000 rupees per year, meaning thereby it's a very good. And I hope so, because this particular scheme, the 65,000 students at a time, when they come out of that educational institute, in fact, they are going to multiply 10 times, meaning thereby they are going to socialize many individuals with reference to education system. Same with reference to skill development, the government is very particular about the skill development of the people. And then Vandan Yojana, because a substantial number of tribal population group, they depend upon the forest and the forest resources. So for them, whatever, in fact, value addition to the forest produce may be done. So Vandan Kendras, they are established, and minimum support price for non-timber forest produce, that's also there in their system. This is all going on. But still, a number of things has to be done. Now, I'm coming to the Uttar Pradesh scenario. And when I'm saying Uttar Pradesh is the biggest state in India with reference to population. Can you imagine, till 1971 census, not a single scheduled tribe is visible in Uttar Pradesh? This one important question. How many scheduled tribes they are notified there? Only 5. So what's the reason? Why, in a vast population of 23 crores, scheduled tribe population is very less? For that, we need to visit the early debates in the UP Vidhan Sabha. And when I was exploring the debates there in the UP Vidhan Sabha, the things were all very strange. In 1954-55, one of the members is asking to the minister concerned. At that time, they are not using the word scheduled tribe, but they are using Adivasi. And what he is asking, how many Adivasis are there in Uttar Pradesh? In how many districts they are residing? And what are the welfare programs they are initiated by the government for them? This is a very important question. Minister is replying, we have got information from 28 districts and asked for the information from other district magistrates. Then after, I couldn't get any information. I searched more, and later on, a year after, in the debate, what I am getting, minister is furnishing a list of scheduled tribe, a list of Adivasis, I'll say not scheduled tribe, I'm saying Adivasis. And in that, there are nearly 25, 30 odd Adivasis, sorry. And these constitute nearly 1 lakh in nearly 16 to 17 districts of Uttar Pradesh. This is good. In Vidhan Sabha, we are discussing about their problems, their population, their existence, their welfare measures, their programs is going on. But when it comes to their notification, it's absent. So that's the problem, in fact. You are not identifying them. You are not notifying them how you are going to work for the welfare and the development of these particular groups. This is one important question, in fact. Then in 1967, when the reminder was there, certain tribal groups, in fact, they were all taken the course too. And now in 1971, for the first time, the tribal population group was counted. If I go by the decadal growth rate till 1950 to 1971, there is a 0% growth rate as far as the tribe is concerned in Uttar Pradesh. 1971 to 81 is a 17% growth rate. 81 to 91 is a 23% growth rate. 91 to 2001 is a 26%. And from 2001 to 2011, it's a growth of 950%. During this time period, what happened? Those tribal groups who couldn't get the identity of scheduled tribe, they initiated the movement. And as a result of that, in 2002 and 2003, certain tribal groups from scheduled caste, they were shifted to the scheduled tribe. And as a result of that, a substantial number of population is visible as per as scheduled tribe in Uttar Pradesh. Well, before that, they were not. So this one, if you take, for the identification of scheduled tribe, scheduled caste, you have the clear indication of untouchable as one important criteria. But as far as the scheduled tribes is concerned, you don't have any criteria. In fact, you depend upon primitive traits, distinct in culture, geographical isolation, shyness, backwardness, a number of things, and the number of committees constituted, backward class commission in 1955, advisory committee on division of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, that is Lokut committee in 1965, joint committee of parliament on scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, I mean 1967, Chandra committee, a number of so and so forth, they were there, but it's all very difficult. In fact, in the initial years, only five tribal groups, Bhotia, Buxa, Jonsari, Razi, Tharu, being accorded scheduled tribal status, and others in Uttar Pradesh, they were no more there in that. And was the whole process. The presidential order is issued by the president, it comes to the governor's house. Governor is issuing the order to the commissioner. Commissioner is sending that to the district magistrate to sub-district magistrates, from there to the local Lekhpal and others. No one has taken that whole process very seriously, because it was the question of certain communities who are all vulnerable, who don't have voice, who don't have any political assertive face, and that's why they were all neglected. And that's why, in fact, that official dom, in fact, that bureaucratic frames that resulted in the difficulty for this population group, and as a result of that, in Uttar Pradesh, they could not get their proper status. Not only that, with reference to the individual claims, you do have one process. With reference to the community claims, you do have another process. But the modalities, they are not at all, in fact, very clear. And that's why the problem is all there. In 1967, in fact, to save their face, they have notified certain tribal groups. And in 1971, what I said, that they are there. I'll take one very peculiar example of Gond tribe. Gond is a tribe which is recognized in different other states other than Uttar Pradesh. And very striking thing about Gond were considered as Adivasis in the list that has been furnished by the minister concerned in 1955 in the Vidhan Sabha. So they were scheduled tribe. But after that, when the notification came, they were neither scheduled tribe, they were neither scheduled caste. So it's all very difficult. Gond, if you perceive, they are the tribe of Dravidian family and most important non-Aryan or forest tribe in India. They are very much prominently found in Madhya Pradesh and the Gondwana area. That's all very important. Not only that, in Uttar Pradesh, the Gonds who reside, they speak Gondi, Bhojpuri, Bundelkhandi, Hindi, other dialect, wear colorful clothes, worship Janana, the mother creator. In fact, what I want to convey to you, there are features which you consider that, yes, these features, they must be there in many of the tribal communities in order to incorporate them into what you call it as scheduled tribe. In 1955, they are there in the list of Adivasis that has been furnished there in the UP Vidhan Sabha by the minister concerned on the request of the member of a Vidhan Sabha. District Banda is an important district during that time period where their population is there. They said we recognize them as a Adivasi, and for their welfare, number of schemes, number of projects, and number of, amount was sanctioned. The scheduled tribe list of five tribes that has been taken the course to after independence, in fact, in Uttar Pradesh, that has been notified by the president, they are no more there. In 1967 also, they are missing, they are not at all there. And they were put in the scheduled caste category and that too confined to certain districts of Sonbhadra and Mirzapur. Rest of UP, they are there in the general category in fact, in 1976, late 70s, meaning thereby they were nowhere. So now, after initiating a, what you call it as a movement, they are getting a status of scheduled caste. And that too, to a certain district later on, that area was increased to whole of the UP. Now they are the scheduled caste in whole of the UP. Once upon a time in 1955, they were Adivasis. During that time period of 55 till 70s, they are nowhere. Then in 1976, they are scheduled caste. And then after 26 years of whole movement, now they are scheduled tribe, and that too in 13 districts of Uttar Pradesh. Meaning thereby, just from this particular one example, there are a number of tribes, in fact. There are a number of tribes who are not at all in a position, or who do not have numbers at their side, who do not have political voice at their part. And that's why, instead of doing all their exercises, it's very difficult for them, in fact, to get the status of the scheduled tribe. And they are all doing that. For example, in fact, I was just reading, Kol tribe was there, and they have initiated the movement to convert them from scheduled caste to scheduled tribe. But the UP government in 2013, they proposed that, but later on that they were not included in 2019 general elections. They boycotted the elections, meaning thereby number of tribal groups, they are there, and they are pressing for their demands. But anyhow, they are not getting, in fact, their position as a scheduled tribe, though in 1955 list they were there, and that list was not a common list. That list was presented by a minister there in the Vidhan Sabha, and that list carried with it the different, programs and policies for the welfare of the Adivasis. I'm saying Adivasis for them during that time period. Then there is another one, is the Kahar caste group also. In certain areas, they are getting the benefit of the scheduled tribe in different states. But in Uttar Pradesh, they are all taking the course too, but they are not getting that. Meaning what I want to convey to you, that the population group is more, you do have a political voice, you pressurize the government, and then only your case is treated. Meaning thereby, there are no objective formulations, there are no objective criteria. It's very difficult, in fact, to do that. So in Uttar Pradesh, a majority, they were not at all included there. Is one number of castes, scheduled caste groups, scheduled castes and other caste groups, they are there who are fighting for the status of a scheduled tribe, but they are not. Another very important community is denotified nomadic and semi-nomadic tribes. Is another important community, in fact, as if I go by the statistics, in fact, in 1911, this law was replaced by a new act, and again, history is there. And in 1944-49, what happened, Government of India appointed a committee, and as a consequence of the recommendations of the Criminal Tribes Law Repeal Act 1952 was passed, whereby all such laws stood repealed through India with effect from August 31st, 1952. In fact, these criminal tribal groups, in fact, which were all called criminal tribes, they were later called as denotified tribes. But for them, there are also certain peculiar features here in Uttar Pradesh. Certain denotified tribes, they are included there in the list of scheduled castes. They are fighting for the independent status. Others, they are nowhere. Policy frames, as far as the welfare is concerned, this is all difficult, no doubt. Number of committees, they were constituted, and this particular government has also constituted a committee to identify these nomadic tribes, and they're all working for their welfare, but it's very, very difficult, in fact, how to take up their claim. So after taking this all, what I want to in fact discuss with you is the post-90s. What are the legal frames, legal enactments that were taken up by the government for the welfare, directly or indirectly, and how these direct and indirect benefit they are there on their part. For example, the Forest Rights Act, it's not easy. It was not very easy for the tribal groups to get that because they have initiated certain movement, they have initiated certain agitation for that, and the story goes like that. The environmental protectionists, they're all there, and the name of environment, number of cases they are filed there in the court. One particular person, Godha Varman, from that Nilgiri forest area, he filed a petition there in the court that they are destroying the forest. Maybe it's the government, maybe it's people who are residing there. And that's why certain action has to be taken from the side of the government, from the side, or directive should be issued by the court. Justice Verma was there at that time. He has taken recognizance of that. And later on, he issued that, yes, all the activities there in the forest areas, they will be conducted under the instructions of the court, meaning thereby it was all difficult time period because major tribal population groups, they were depending upon forests, and they'll have to wait for the Supreme Court for each and every activities they have to perform. And agitation occurred, and later on the government came up with the Forest Rights Act. And this Forest Rights Act, in fact, is all very important. Along with PESA, the Forest Rights Act, creating number of hurdles and problems as far as the different developmental projects are concerned. The people say so. The policymakers say so, that it's becoming a difficult proposition, in fact, as far as the development is concerned. And we need to have something more than that. And that's why a number of things are going on, for example, with reference to environmental impact assessment and social impact assessment. Maybe there are certain discussions going on at present. Is one. So we'll see how that discussion is going to unfold, and what's the draft policy, how that draft is going to be taken up by the government in a proper way. This is another important debate. But what my submission at present is that, yes, government, I think, will not go against the welfare of the tribal population group or the vulnerable communities. And they'll come up with, I think, certain positive results. I always say, in the words of Max Weber, there are three important aspects of law. One is the philosophical aspect of law. When a law is framed, when a law is made, it do have a philosophy. What for this law is going to be. There's the internal perspective of law, which we say the jurisprudence of law, meaning thereby consistencies, inconsistencies. In fact, this is the domain of lawyers, this is the domain of judges. And then the third, that's the most important, is the sociology of law, the external aspect of law, how the law is going to work there in the field. And that's the most neglected area in the Indian academia. For example, after independence, when the schedule was all being prepared, it was a pure administrative exercise. No doubt, certain scholars, certain anthropologists, they were there at the helm of the affair, but more or less it was an administrative exercise, and the academia has taken it as it is. No question, no studies, no, in fact, criticisms, they were all there. And later on, these administrative categories, in fact, they later on converted into the standard, and as a result of that, a number of tribal population that couldn't get position there in that is one. And same, what I say, that external aspect, how the law is going to impact, that has not been taken up. Number of studies, they are very less. In the Indian scenario, they are absent. Westerners, they are studying that, and that's why whenever it comes to how the law is going to perform there in the field is concerned, we lag behind that, and that's why a number of issues are there, number of problems are there. So whenever any policy formulation is done, and when the policy has to be implemented there in the field, at least in the initial days, so some important sociological studies, some important external studies has to be done as far as the impact of those particular policies are concerned. Maybe it's not very easy, but still, if you're not doing that, we are only confining to philosophy. The philosophy of law is very good. For example, Nehruvian policy of Panchashil is all very good. But what about at the ground level? Same policy framework is destroying the population group he was admiring most. So that we'll have to take into consideration. And as far as development formulation is concerned in India, I already made a submission that we do have a very different approach and very different frame of development. And that's why when we are comparing it with others, maybe we are going to create certain problems for us as well as for the people for whom we are going to create such type of policies. Because our competitive role, the moment we are taking the course to, maybe it's difficult because our scenario is altogether a very unique one. So with this, I rest my discussion, I rest my viewpoints. So I'm open to you all to criticize me, to throw me out of this session, please. Sir, and thank you, Dr. Pandey, for giving me this opportunity to speak.
In fact, there is no question of throwing you out, both on YouTube as well as in the chat box. You are flooded with questions and tremendously positive feedback. One question I just want to share with my participants, that this session is being live streamed on YouTube courtesy Council for Green Revolution, Mr. Yashwant. Because of him, we are able to do that. Thank you so much, Mr. Yashwant. Now, this question I would like to first take from YouTube, which is from...
Ma'am, please be loud because I'm not getting your voice.
Now, am I audible, sir?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. This question is by Dr. Pradeepta Ranjan Patnaik from Orissa. He asks that sociolinguistics of indigenous people has come a serious challenge to linguistic identity of the tribes. How do we save their identity?
Oh, what I am saying now, at least we need to have more researches. And we need to have a comprehensive researches. Linguists, they are doing some research. Sociologists, they are doing some research. Anthropologists, they are doing some research. A political scientist is doing some research. Why don't you put all together? Unless and until we are not doing that in isolation, whatever researches we are doing is only for the academia purpose. It's not going to solve the policy formulations, and it's not going to be useful for the benefit of the people. So we need to take all together, in fact. And it's very nice to see that number of political scientists and economists, they are taking the course to the tribal studies. It's good. It's no more a domain of what you call it as the domain of anthropologists and sociologists now.
Please. Thank you, sir. There is another question from Mr. Amresh Debarma. He asks that, is scheduled tribe identity a fluid category or concept, or does it give a pan solidarity of scheduled tribes through community?
In fact, this is difficult because nowhere in your constitution it is defined anywhere. What are the important features as far as the scheduled tribe is concerned? And that's why we cannot say there is any objective formulations. No. No objective formulations. They are there, and that's why certain tribal groups, they are there in the schedule, and the majority, they are not at all there. And Uttar Pradesh is a good example.
Thank you, sir. There are two questions by Mrs. Kalpana Singh. She asks, why no indigenous and contextual planning approach is there for them, keeping them in center of every plan, rather studying and planning for them from outside? Like, she basically asking why there are no indigenous and contextual planning, keeping them into the center rather than, you know, studying them from external perspective.
Oh, that's important. I already mentioned Nehru. One hand, what he is praising the life of the tribal population like anything. On the other hand, he's taking recourse to a developmental model that encroaches upon the simple living of the tribal population group. But now, the things are changing. Not only that, the tribal population group, they're also recognizing, in fact, themselves as the important power blocks. And in the time to come, maybe the things are going to change. Not only that, now on the policy frames, their participation is there. And earlier also, in fact, the professor was talking about the Gram Panchayat developmental plans and all that. Maybe through these small models of planning, they are being brought up into the planning process. And I think in a time to come, the things will change.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question by Mr. Pramod Kumar, that how the educational rights of tribal communities can be protected.
Government is coming up with a very nice model of Eklavya model. I'm fascinated by that. Why? Because the success of Navodaya Vidyalayas, and on that same model, we are coming up with the Eklavya schools. It's a pure residential schools, and the students don't have to care about their family, their resources, nothing. Everything is all arranged by the government. So if this particular model schools, in fact, they are taking the course in all the tribal areas, I think this is going to change the scene. That's going to change the game.
Yes, sir, that's very true. And one more question from Mr. Bhaskar Gogoi. What are your views on tribal land alienation problems in India and agitation of tribal population on encroachment and alienation of land?
It's important and very contemporary and very old, both. Because whenever you are taking recourse to any developmental plan, the most simple, most vulnerable community is the tribal community. And it seems as if it's very easy to out them from their land. That approach by this Land Acquisition Act of 2013, it comes down. PESA is another important development. And I think the government is sympathetic about, but there are certain parameters of development, in fact, that we have taken recourse to in the course of history that we cannot write off, that we cannot take off. And that's why some problems are there. But I'm hopeful the things they are going to improve. Not only that, I have taken recourse to the study of Paul Grass, where what he's saying in Uttar Pradesh, in one of the projects, a population group is shifted number of times. One for the project, one for the guest house, one for the other things. And after that, where that population group is, no one knows. So that type of frame, in fact, I think is not going to be repeated. And we can be hopeful only. And maybe in a time to come, the things are all going to improve.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Marimuthu, I have unmuted you. Please go ahead.
The question will be the new education policy related, which is taking the tribal into the professional courses or work. It is not going to take as a MPPS or engineering or something else.
You are not audible to me. Please be loud. Please be loud.
Mr. Marimuthu, can you please repeat your question and be loud, please?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Some network issues. Please be little louder.
Yeah, I am from Tamil Nadu, Kanyakumari.
Okay. Please go ahead. Again, repeat your question, please.
New education policy, which is going to be impact on tribals' educations or employment opportunities. New education policy is treating them again. They should go education oriented or the highest stay or jobs oriented. It is in the initial time itself diverting them again their personal oriented work. It is not going to be take to
sir basically Mr.
Mari engineering or something else.
Okay. Actually, because I think there's some network issues, the question is not clear. What I could understand, Mr. Marimuthu, and I'm putting to Professor Sanjay Singh, new education policy 2020 has been launched. So what could be its possible impact on the tribal communities in terms of education and employment opportunities?
It's all very important. I haven't gone through the whole education policy of 2020, but whatever impression I am getting from the different reports and the different writings, the approach of the government is all very clear. And maybe this is going to be a turning point. And let's see how it unfolds. It's going to be a turning point for the marginalized sections also. Because the plan they have, this is going to be very, very, in fact, positive impact to see. In fact, later on any other platform, the movement will meet. I'll come up with the study of that, and then only comprehensively I'll talk about this. But still, whatever primary information I have, I think it's good. It's going to have a change. It's going to have a drastic shift as far as the vulnerable section of the population is concerned.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for responding to all the concerns so patiently. In fact, there are a few more questions, sir, but we are running out of time. Just a quick response from you. Your observation on the latest environment impact assessment policy, and what do you see is the future of Adivasi studies in India?
It's a very interesting. One of the Fulbright scholar who visited our university once upon a time, I asked her, what about environmental impact assessment and social impact assessment in your place? She laughed at me from America. She laughed at me and said, what you are talking about? We go a bit as far as environmental impact assessment is concerned. But as far as the social impact assessment is concerned, we are least bothered about that. Here in India, we have taken that policy formulation of an environmental impact assessment, and we are doing that, no doubt. Not very few, in fact, projects are there which are hindered due to environmental impact assessment. Otherwise, most of the projects, in fact, they get the green signal. So we can understand that whatever environmental impact assessment we are doing, we do have a certain number of parameters, which we try to fulfill, in fact, from the side of the agency who does that, and from the side of the government who wants to have a clearance for that. So taking together, in fact, what I say that the proposal, the government is saying that on certain projects, we are going to take up the projects and later on we'll go by that. I don't think that's going to work. And there is no need to do that. There is no need to do that. And it's too early. Why we are just jumping upon conclusions? Let the government finalize the whole process, and then only, we are there in the position to talk about that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for not only a very, very intellectual presentation in an extempore format, touching upon sociological significance of Adivasis in India and the various policies which were put to them at various points of time. I'm extremely thankful to you for your very, very thought-provoking presentation, sir. On behalf of Department of Sociology, I extend a very, very cordial thanks to you for your invaluable presentation and invaluable views. I'm sure this will go a long way in developing sensitivity towards the Adivasis in India, which have been badly hit because of this COVID-19, especially in terms of migration and in terms of lack of health facilities. Thank you for sensitizing us, Professor Sanjay Singhji.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. And I'm very thankful to Nizam College for inviting me to deliver the lecture. I'm very thankful.
Thank you, sir. So with your permission, now I would like to invite our next speaker, sir. She is Mrs. Devi, a very, very young, dynamic Deputy Registrar Academics from IIT Hyderabad, who holds a double master's in English Literature as well as Sociology. She is presently pursuing her PhD in Development Studies at the Center for Economic and Social Studies, Hyderabad. She was a Group 1 officer and she served in Tribal Welfare Department for a decade prior to joining IIT Hyderabad. She is Mrs. Chanchala Devi, and she also has worked with National Institute for Plant Health Management, and at leisure she enjoys gardening, painting and cooking. So we have with us a very dynamic young Group 1 officer, an administrative officer, who will share her actual practical experiences with Tribal Welfare Department. Thank you so much, Madam Chanchala Devi, for joining us, and over to you now. Yes, Madam, please continue.
Thank you, Dr. Vinita. Thank you for the very kind and generous brief introduction you have given of mine. A very hearty good morning to the distinguished panel and dear friends, to all those who have joined us. A very good morning. So,
we can see your screen, Dr. Chanchala Devi. We can see.
Yes, doctor. So before joining the Tribal Welfare Department, I had a very romantic notion of tribe, very similar to the ideal typical notion that many of us have. So here I have put this picture of the Santilinese tribe, Andaman and Nicobar Islands. This tribe is a particularly vulnerable tribal group, and the numbers are in double digit. It's a very stagnating and very declining populated tribe this is. So this is the romantic kind of a notion we have, most of us have, of the tribe. Now, when we think of tribe, what do these people have in common is our basic understanding, that they have a distinct language and culture. But when I set out for my first training as a Group 1 officer to Srikakulam district, there is this ITDA, Integrated Tribal Development Agency of Sitampeta. That was my first posting as a trainee district tribal welfare officer. So when I first went there, I saw that the Savaras, which are the predominant tribes in that area, there were a group of boys, Savara boys, who were wearing nice t-shirts and jeans pants. So this is not the notion we generally have. We think their language and their culture is very distinct. Now this Savara, a sect of Savara, is a particularly vulnerable tribal group. And what do we mean by particularly vulnerable tribal groups? That they have three characteristics. One is their population is diminishing and very stagnating. The second is they have very low levels of literacy. And the third characteristic is they are still into the pre-agrarian level of technology. Now, in this context, we assume that the Savaras will look very different. Their dressing will be very different. Their language will be different. Their culture will be very different. But what I saw was a little different. Then we have this notion that they are very geographically isolated. These tribes or these people are geographically isolated. They live in remote, inaccessible, hilly and forested regions only. However, a lot of tribes live in plain areas too. And even with those living in remote regions, there is a lot of movement to tribal areas and from tribal areas. So we have this migration of tribal people into the mainlands, whereas a lot of people from the mainland who are non-tribals have been inhabiting the scheduled areas these days. Then three, we have this assumption that all these people are still engaged in pre-agrarian subsistence economy. That is predominantly hunting and gathering societies. For example, in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, there is this Chenchu tribes, which is again classified as a particularly vulnerable tribal group. However, this kind of tribes which are into hunting and food gathering societies, they are still very few in number. And today, most of the tribes have taken to agriculture, and agriculture has become their mainstay. In Srikakulam, Sitampeta, I have seen in interior villages also, tribes cultivating pineapple and other crops. They cultivate turmeric and so on. So additionally, we find them working in the industrial belts also. For example, in Chota Nagpur belt, we have numerous industries that employ local tribes. Mundas, Oraons, Hos, all these tribes, they are employed in a lot of industries there and factories. Further, with the expansion of service economy, we also find many of them taking up service sector jobs. In those who are urban and, for example, in our own Hyderabad city, I stay in Hyderabad, and in our own Hyderabad, I am sure many of us would have seen Ola and Uber cabs. And on these cabs, there are this red color sticker marking on the bonnets or the backside, which says that they are financed by ST Corporation, SC Corporation. So they are all tribes. So the scheduled tribes are not limiting themselves to these remote and inaccessible areas any longer. They have come out and they are taking up different occupations. So they have been practicing variety of occupations. Next assumption which we all make is that these people solely believe in magic, nature worship and animism. However, I have noticed quite a few of them celebrating Hindu festivals. I have also noticed quite a few of them attending churches. In fact, we all know that most of the tribes in Northeast are Christian in faith, while they still retain many of their tribal beliefs and practices. Then we also think that these people have an egalitarian social order, that Jal Jangal Jameen is owned by all. Now, what is Jal Jangal Jameen? Jal means water, jungle means forest, and Jameen means the earth. So these are resources, or these are things which tribes feel very connected to. They identify with. However, today, this is far from truth. They have been displaced from their commons. The notions of private property are established even within the tribal fold. A system of stratification has emerged within them. There are elites, then there are educated and conscious tribal middle classes. And apart from class divisions, we also notice that there has emerged a gender differentiation within tribal communities. Now, what do all these developments convey? These kinds of changes that we are witnessing, what does these communicate to us? For me, at least, three things I am able to understand. The first thing that comes to my mind is that these communities are in a state of flux and are witnessing large-scale social change. The sources of changes could be colonial, they could be policies of the Indian state. They could also be the forces of globalization, liberalization, or modernization. Not going into the source of these changes, but for sure there has been social change. The second thing that comes to my mind is that these communities are not monolithic or homogeneous. They are highly heterogeneous and amorphous in nature. This reminds me that in the chat box, I have seen one of the participants who raised this question, and even Professor Sanjay has beautifully answered it. So what we understand is that these tribal communities are not monolithic. They vary by racial characteristics. They speak many languages and dialects. They inhabit diverse regions. They engage in various occupations. And importantly, the way we try to define, a lot of anthropologists and sociologists try to define tribes is with regard to the differential stages of cultural contact with what we call the mainstream. This is why I think the third thing that I feel, it is so difficult and problematic in defining what a tribe is. And that is why we all have not arrived at or agreed upon a standard definition of tribe. The term tribe is highly fluid and it is not standard at all. And perhaps this is the reason why even our constitution, we do not have a definition. Whatever definitions we have, we read in sociology books and anthropology books, are all very fluid. They are indicative in nature, representative in nature, but they are not the be all and the end all. So this, I want to bring your attention to a caricature that I have, that I stumbled upon. And this is illustrative of what I have spoken so far. Now here is perhaps a researcher or a journalist who is asking a tribal person, tell me about the experience of living in unity with nature, like your tribal ancestors thousands of years before you. Now, interestingly, we see in the picture that there is this hut with a DTH connection and there is radio. So this is illustrative of what I have spoken so far. The indication that there is social change that tribes are witnessing. Moving on, for the benefit of those who are not aware of what the Tribal Welfare Department core functions are, or what it is and what it does, I have just made one slide to talk about the outline of the Tribal Welfare Department. So there is the core department of tribal welfare, and primarily the first thing that the department takes care of, it runs a network of educational institutions. Now these educational institutions are of various types. There are these hostels, there are ashram schools, there are primary schools, alternate schools, and as Professor Sanjay has talked about, Eklavya Model Residential Schools, EMRS. So there are different kinds of schools, educational institutions. The hostels are just places which provide residential lodging and boarding facilities. Ashram schools are residential in nature, whereas primary schools are just places without residents. The alternate schools are for dropout children. The second core activity of the department is monitoring tribal welfare activities through the staff at grassroots level. Now, in plain areas, we have district offices, which are manned by district tribal welfare officers with their own staff. And here in these plain areas, the activities are mostly limited to supporting education and livelihood. Then there are these districts which have a lot of concentration of scheduled tribes, PVTGs, and they have concentrated pockets of scheduled areas wherein we have the ITDAs, the Integrated Tribal Development Agencies. In these districts, there are senior officers, such as IAS officers, who man the offices. There, the activities are more holistic, ranging from habitat development, meeting the health needs, apart from the education and the livelihood requirements. Then the core department also takes care of inter and intra-departmental coordination. Now, by inter-department coordination, what I mean is tribal welfare department coordinates with almost 40 odd departments for monitoring tribal subplan, whether it is at the district level or at the state level. Now, this is to ensure that the tribal subplan funds are properly allocated, utilized, and the monitoring of the same. Now, for the TSP portion, I will again detail later in my subsequent slides. Then there is this intra-departmental coordination also, which the core department takes care of. The intra-department is within the department. There are a lot of wings and divisions, and the core department coordinates with all these wings and divisions, which have specific functions. So here we can see TRICAR, which is the tribal corporation. This division mainly deals with economic support schemes in various sectors, such as agriculture, infrastructure, minor irrigation schemes, land purchase, petty businesses, conservation cum development programs, and the skill development. So these are various activities for which TRICAR funds. The funding is in the mode of subsidies or facilitating bank loans. And more often, the focus is to target through self-help groups rather than through individuals. So the funding is more to self-help groups. Next is the Gurukulam. Here, this division is again runs its own network of educational institutions. The difference being that these are better administered, they have better funding, better resources, they're more competent and well-qualified teachers, and the recruitment, the admissions of students is merit-based, unlike the core department, which admits students on saturation basis, in the sense that any student can be a part of the core department's educational institution. However, in Gurukulam, it is merit-based admissions. So the performance of these institutions is a little better. Then coming to the TCRNTI, this is the Tribal Cultural Research and Training Institute. This wing takes care of the twin functions, as the name suggests, the research activities and the training activities. So the research wing has done a lot of ethnographic studies. As of now, the quality of the research has come down, if I may say so. Initially, it was formed in like 60s, but later in 70s and 80s, there were some very nice studies taken up. But as of now, there is a lot of bureaucratic overload, and so the quality of studies has come down. Then there is this training function that this wing takes care of. The training comprises of teacher training programs, sensitization programs with respect to land transfer regulation, ROFR, that is Recognition of Forest Rights, PISA Act, and many such other issues. It also conducts verification claims regarding tribal identity. So there are so many tribes that have so many people claim tribal status, and so many false cases also come up when the officials have to go to the field, inquire, and verify whether the claims are proper or not. Next is the GCC, which is Girijan Cooperative Corporation. This wing has this mandate of supplying essential commodities through a chain of DR depots. DR means daily requirement depots to the remote and inaccessible terrains. So the essential commodities are supplied to the tribals through these depots. Then GCC is also into assistance in the form of agricultural credit facilities to poor tribal farmers. The best thing about GCC is that it has monopoly rights over minor forest produce, almost 20 odd items. It has monopoly rights. This means that the minor forest produce is bought from the tribals by GCC, and no other intermediaries can buy from them. This is done with a view to ensure that the tribals are not exploited at the hands of these intermediaries or non-tribals who procure from the tribals at a very lower prices, the minor forest produce, and they sell it at a higher cost in the outside markets. So to avoid that kind of exploitation, economic exploitation, the monopoly rights have been given to GCC. The next thing is the Tribal Power Corporation, which is called TRIPCO. The mandate is to construct, generate, and operate mini hydel power projects and other conventional power projects in scheduled areas. Next is the TRIMCO, which is Tribal Mining Corporation Limited, Company Limited. It supports safe and scientific mining. We have our own engineering wing, which takes care of the engineering works, providing infrastructural needs such as roads, construction of buildings, community halls, schools, colleges, etc., providing drinking water, taking up minor irrigation projects, etc. So these are the various functions performed by Tribal Welfare Department through its various wings. Coming back to the theme of the ideal and the real, so I wish to share my reflections in two areas. The first I have identified is the area of education, and the second is the workings of bureaucracy in Tribal Welfare Department. Coming to education. So the first thing that comes to my mind is regarding the student participation. The substantial part of tribal welfare budget is earmarked for education. I can say that around 60% of the budget is earmarked for education out of from the tribal welfare funds. Now government provides to its students food, residence, cosmetic charges, plates and glasses, trunk boxes, bedding material, dresses are provided. Then we also give stitching charges for the students. In fact, the hair cutting charges are also given. For girls, very sensibly, sanitary napkins are also provided. This apart to the educational institutions, library books and sports material is also given. So with this kind of meeting necessities of poor tribal children, despite all these efforts, even if the government does these in an imperfect manner, the expectation that we all have is that there should be some good attendance in the schools. However, in my first posting in Medak district as district tribal welfare officer, I witnessed that during harvest season of sugarcane, most students absent themselves, and once they go to their homes, they come back after like 1 or 2 months. Now this points us to a lot of things. It reflects their economic conditions. And this the I spoke to so many of the students, and what they said is the pressure from the family is always there as to they are the earning hands for the family in such seasons. But apart from that, what entices these students is the pocket money which they get by going and participating in the harvesting. Taking this into account, I always wondered if the academic calendar for tribal students could be tweaked based on local needs. This is a question I pose to the academicians and the policy makers. I'm sure a lot of thought would have gone into it, but I don't know what has happened. But we have never altered their curricula. Their curricula and their syllabus is always in line with the other mainland or mainstream society, Indian society. So this reminds me of a similar concept which I read way back. A school by name Vidyavanam, this school operates in the tri-junction of three states, that is Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Karnataka. It has a lot of Irula children studying in this school. The concept of the school I found was very interesting. One facet of it was that learning is done in small groups in the school. So this this thing is very close to what Abhijit Banerjee talks about through RCTs, that is randomized controlled trials. In one of his article, he says that it is not better qualified teachers or better pay conditions that result in better educational outcomes. He says rather it is the teaching in small groups which does the magic. So this is one concept which Vidyavanam school has taken care of, and the teaching is done in small groups here. The next thing that they follow is the curriculum. They have made it highly relatable. For example, the geography teacher teaches about the local rivers and streams, and the emphasis is more on that rather than on understanding about the Ganga or the Yamuna somewhere far off. Then the other relevant thing is that the classes there are theme based. So they identify a particular theme. For example, if water is the theme, then the history teacher will teach civilizations which were born because of water, emerged because of water, say the Indus Valley civilization. The science teacher will talk about the chemistry of water. The maths teacher will make the students understand how to arrive at the volume of water. While the geography teacher will talk about the local water bodies, the rivers, the lakes, the tanks, or the rainwater harvesting, etc. The English teacher will talk about the poetry and prose on the subject of water. So such kind of theme-based classes are organized in the school. Now, these interesting facets were the part of the curricula and the syllabus of this particular school. But the irony was that the parents enrolled their wards not because of these interesting things, but because they wanted their children to learn English. So this is the irony. My next reflection is regarding the quality of education. Why are some schools better? Why do they perform better when compared to others? I previously spoke about these Gurukulam educational institutions which perform better. As much as my understanding goes, these institutions, I have seen in my own experience that rather than just hostels or just schools, hostels which house the students and they take care of the lodging and boarding necessities, but nevertheless the classes are not conducted in the hostels. While for primary schools, they do not provide the lodging boarding facilities. So rather than such kind of institutions, the performance is always better in residential school patterns. And when the teachers are motivated enough, whether in terms of better pay or appreciation or various other incentives, the performance is a little better. when the admissions are based on merit, then the performance is again a little better. So there are different things which go into why the quality of education in particular schools is better than in other schools. Coming to the policies part, I have always wondered why there is so much of drift in the policies. So in my own experience, I find that there is always a talk that good policies and bad implementation is what happens in India. And there is this new realization that good policies, if they cannot be implemented well, they amount to bad policies. What is the problem with policies in India? Being a part of the government, I have witnessed that the first major problem is that there is no continuity of schemes or policies or programs. These are all system driven. These are all not system driven or not need driven, but they are people driven. By people, I mean not the citizens, but the politicians or the administrators who are in charge of the systems. So they drive what is to be done. They drive everything. But it is not out of the necessities that a tribe feels that we carve out the required policies. I will talk about a particular program, though I will not name program for good reasons. There was a commissioner of tribal welfare department who started one educational program. This was because he earlier worked in a voluntary organization, and he was into this field of education. And perhaps what motivated him was the ACER report, which says that a lot of students who are studying in their higher classes, such as 9th class, 10th class, they are not even, they do not have the basic knowledge of the three R's, that is reading, writing, and arithmetic, which is compatible with second class students or third class students. So here in private schools or good schools, we find that the 10th class students are very good in certain disciplines, and their analytical abilities is very good. Their understanding is very good. But sadly, in a lot of schools, the basic three R's, which a 10th class student is supposed to have the knowledge of, he is not comparable even to a third class student. So based on this premise and his own early experiences, he started a program, education program, wherein all the tribal welfare education institutions, around 600 in number, were asked to follow a particular schedule where before and after the school hours, they were taught classes. And for under this program, in coordination with Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, we came out with a set of textbooks focusing on, apart from these 3 hours, life skills as well. So there was a new curriculum drawn out, new textbooks that came up. Lot happened, and it was with a lot of pomp and vigor. It was launched by the then chief minister. Lot of money went into it. And then this thing carried on for like 1 to 2 years. And then the commissioner was transferred to some other department, and the entire program was disbanded. And very unfortunately, I have to say this, that there were so many textbooks that got wasted. They were locked up in a particular room. And then as officials, we did not know how to go about it. Because if we thought about giving it to some students, some poor students free of cost, just giving them like that. But then we understood that the transport cost will be more. And so finally, we just disposed of those books in the darkness of the night, so that it does not come into the knowledge of anybody, and or the media attention is not drawn to it. So these are the inner workings of how policies are taken forward, how they are disbanded, and how there is no continuity of these programs or policies. This is why we think we do not get the desired or required or desired outcomes in following government policies. Next thing which I would reflect on is the post-matric scholarship, PMS, which I mean, post-matric scholarships, the concept of reservation and the distortions these produces. Now, ideally, as a part of Tribal Welfare Department, I have always taken pride in this particular program of post-matric scholarship scheme. This is supposed to be, and this is acclaimed as one of the most wonderful programs because this has got a lot of desired outcomes, such as it has drawn a lot of tribal people into this education system. And in fact, it is supposed to be the most successful program in India. A lot of money has been, a lot of budget has been earmarked for this program. And when we see, look at the numbers, the students availing post-matric scholarships scheme has kept increasing manifold through the decades. Now here, this is very beautiful and it has been done very well, but ideally, such policies produce equality, but in reality, they have produced their own inequalities. Why do I say this? I'm sure a lot of academicians here would have heard about this study which was conducted by Suma Chitnis in 1972, where she talks about the state of Maharashtra, wherein there is 3.5% of SC population in Maharashtra, and they have utilized 15% of the post-matric scholarship scholarships. Whereas Bihar, where there is 10% of SC population, they have used only 6% of post-matric scholarships. So this is the variables in terms of states. Some states have performed better, though they have lesser population, while some other states which have higher population, they use lesser incentives or amenities used by the given by the government. Now, the Maharashtra government also made a study in 1962-63, where this thing was brought out that Mahars, which comprise 35% of SC population of that particular state, accounted for 86% of the post-matric scholarships that were dispersed. In contrast, there was this scheduled caste of Mangs, which constituted 33% of the total SC population of that state, but they accounted only for 2% of the scholarships. So these are the various inequalities that are thrown up time and again. These examples I have picked up are related to scheduled caste communities, and no different we find it with regard to SC communities. Myself, I tried to analyze going through the list of candidates making it to the final selection of Indian Civil Services in a particular around 3 to 4 years back. There were 98 scheduled tribes selected under ST category. So this was in 2014. The merit list I was seeing was pertaining to 2014. In this list of 98 STs who were selected, 29 of them belonged to the Meena tribe. Now this accounts for 1/3 of the total selections. This we are seeing in the backdrop that there are around 700 odd tribal communities in India. So if there are 700 tribal communities, out of which one community year after year is selected into the highest, most prestigious examination of this country, and it is walking into the powers of corridor every time, then what kind of equality are we going towards? These schemes, which are meant to make people equal, by themselves they are bringing inequality. They have their own distortions. They produce their own distortions. So these are the dialectics that we keep witnessing. Coming to my last slide. Now, these are my reflections on bureaucracy. In India, the conception is that there is too much bureaucracy. If we examine this criticism closely, we notice an important contradiction as a paradox. One, that we are over-bureaucratized when it comes to procedures. And two, we are under-bureaucratized when it comes to personnel. We just keep listening to all these things that government officers or government employees do not have much work. But on the contrary, I myself have worked for so many days, 24/7 kind of work we take up. So these are all the paradoxes and contradictions that are not new to us. This is what we called as bureaucratic overload. The posts and positions are not filled up. Often they are left emptied. Here I would try to tell you of this thing that in tribal welfare department, as part of our job chart as district tribal welfare officers, we were supposed to inspect these educational institutions and ensure that they are running smoothly and efficiently. As part of our job chart, we had to verify, when we go to a particular institution, we have to verify around 23 registers, which is, I think, humanly not possible with the kind of workload that we have. And when I visit a particular tribal welfare institution, say in Medak, from my headquarters, which is at Sangareddy, if I have to visit a particular institution, which is in Zahirabad, then I have to go all the way, travel for around 3 hours up and 3 hours down. And then there I have to, in a particular institution, go through these 23 registers and see that everything is in order. Now, this is what we all are aware of when we call when we talk about bureaucracy. Next is the surprise inspections. Now, these surprise inspections are a tool to check corruption. These are a tool to check the workings of an institution to ensure that people are not prepared to present the good side of the institution or their good workings. We go on these inspections. However, when I was working as a trainee officer in Srikakulam district, the driver who was attached to me, he told me, when we started one day, I said, please take the vehicle in this direction. Then he just told me in a very friendly manner, madam, you think that these are surprise inspections. There is no surprise element in these inspections because the drivers in some stop, they pass on the information to the hostel welfare officers or the wardens or the principals that the officer is on way and they will inspect your education institution. So this is how the information is leaked. And this just doesn't happen to the drivers, to the institution in charges, but it also happens through the pawn shop people on the way, through the shop owners who are there on the way when we are going. So there is this entrenched networks which keep leaking and providing information. The next is the panel has already elaborated on the idea of tribal subplan. Now, the concept of tribal subplan, I'm sure a lot of people here know. The tribal subplan is a very beautiful concept in itself. It was started in the year 1974, but it was enacted in 2013. And this policy or program is about earmarking a part of all various departments' activities fund or budget should be earmarked for the tribal population. So this means that if in Andhra Pradesh 6% is the tribal population, then agriculture department has to earmark 6% of its budget for tribal population. Similarly, horticulture department has to earmark 6%. Similarly, every other department, whether it is roads and building, whether it is irrigation department, whether it is animal husbandry department, or any other, whether it is rural development department. So every department has to earmark that much of percentage of their funding for the either the scheduled tribes, individual scheduled tribes, or to the scheduled area habitations. This is the concept of tribal subplan. The funding should be in proportion to the population is the concept. This is the theory part of it. And when it comes to practice, when I was in Medak, I found it so difficult to explain this to my fellow colleagues, the other district officers. And every time there was a review meeting called by the district collector, what very conveniently most of my colleagues were doing from other departments was simply making a table showing that if 100 is their budget, they were showing 6% as being spent on the tribal population. So this was done on paper. In fact, it was for these reasons that this was understood at the higher levels of government. And so they came up with an act and it became statutory in nature. And later they have also thought about penalizing the departments which were not performing and rewarding those with better performances. But on ground, the situation remains very, very fluid, and it is not as per our expectations or as per the requirements. It is nowhere near the perfect. So these all things may sound very anecdotal, but these are my experiences. The last thing which I would want to talk about with regard to this bureaucracy is, I would draw your attention to what I saw in a particular tribal welfare hostel in Medak. Now, when we think of corrupt people, we think of them as totally corrupt in all ways. But here I interacted with a warden who was known to be corrupt, but he, I saw, had come up with a class, the best ethics and value class or lesson that could ever be imparted in the classrooms, any good education institutions classrooms. So he came up with this novel idea of what he termed it as Nijayati Kottu. The literal translation of this will be honest shop. What he did was, he in his hostel, he has put a table and he put a lot of stationery on the table, such as pens, pencils, notebooks, papers, staplers, etc. All these things which students often use. And he put a list there indicating the price of each of the items. And then he put a box there and he told all his the hostel inmates that if anybody wanted to buy a particular item from that table, he had to simply put the cash amount into that box. And nobody would, there is no record of that, or there is nobody monitors whether somebody has taken it without paying properly, or trying to see if people are fooling around, paying less amount, or there is nobody to monitor any of these things. And it surprisingly so happened, and I was told by the warden himself that not once did he find even one student or inmate stealing from that table. This was the way he taught them honesty. A so-called corrupt officer who was teaching ethics class to his hostel students. So these are my different reflections based on my own working experiences. My first posting was in Sitampet as trainee officer, Srikakulam district. Then 2 years I worked in Medak district as district tribal welfare officer. Later on, I was posted as deputy director in tribal corporation as DGM, deputy general manager. And subsequently, I took up planning and monitoring role in the tribal welfare department. These are some of my reflections. I would conclude by sharing this interesting picture, which again dispels the myth of the ideal typical tribe. Here is the Jatapu woman who is learning to sign. She has her husband beside her, and they are learning to put their signature. This tribe, and this photograph is from Vijayanagaram district. This is here I will end, and I would thank Dr. Vinita for giving me this wonderful opportunity of sharing my reflections with all of you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for a very experience-based presentation. In fact, we have been, as teachers of social anthropology, Adivasi studies, or tribal studies, we have been teaching these in these classes, but it is always advisable and always good to get a practitioner's perspective, and that is what you have presented to us. Ma'am, with your permission, there are a few questions which I would like to ask you, which have been posed by the participants. This question is from Mrs. Kalpana Singh. She asks that apart from economic interdependence of tribal people, when they land in mainstream society, they form bottom strata in hierarchy. What should be done to ensure that they become part of mainstream? So, and this one more question I will be, because this also is by Kalpana Singh. Why media turns blank towards tribal culture?
So, yes, I agree that when they become a part of the mainstream culture, more often than not, they take up the lowest strata of the society. But this is not the case every time. In fact, Virginius Kaka says that when they integrate with the Hindu society, they integrate at different levels. It is not always at the lowest strata. Now, as I told in my presentation also, there's different classes have emerged in these, among these. Coming to the mainstream society, when they try to integrate with the mainstream society, if they are in the bottom strata, what can we do? The best thing, always all academicians and policy makers have agreed upon, are building on their educational capabilities. That is the one solution for any kind of human development. And we have seen the different kinds of problems that we keep facing when we try to implement these educational programs and schemes. If we can plug those gaps, I think we can do a very good job in bringing them at par with the rest of the society.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question is from Mr. Pramod Kumar Koturu. Can we really expect increase in teachers' dedication towards tribes if salary and incentives increase?
Yes, to an extent I agree, because when I have met a lot of teachers in the scheduled areas, they work under very pressing conditions, environmental conditions, which they are not otherwise used to. So there is this this thing I have not mentioned in my presentation, but I would like to bring this to all of your notice, that there is this particular government order in combined AP as well as AP and Telangana now, wherein we follow that in all the educational institutions, 100% recruitment should be from the local tribes as teachers. So that the outsiders don't come and exploit one, and they don't look down upon the tribal people. This is a common thing, that when outsiders come, they think that their culture is superior. They are very ethnocentric in their attitude, and they have this thing that their culture is superior when it comes to, when they compare themselves to the tribal culture. Very sorry state of affairs. And to avoid all of this, there was a lot of push from the government side, and they have made this GO, and sadly the Supreme Court very recently has trashed this down. I don't know what is happening there. I have to still brush up with a lot of current affairs, but these are the happenings. So better pay is definitely a good incentive. What there lot of us get when we are posted to such areas is a bad climate allowance, which is actually peanuts. So it is not really so motivating. If a person has this social service bent of mind, only then they are very dedicated and they do a very good job. But otherwise, most of them feel very demotivated when they carry out. So these things may to a great extent bring up the educational standards, better pay scales, and more competent teachers, and all these things. But I think we have to look at this in a comprehensive manner. Like I said, there are so many gaps to be plugged.
Thank you, ma'am. And this will take the last question. The question is on tribal displacement, ma'am, from Sunita. The question is, like, what is government's stand on tribal displacement? It always exploits tribal communities, but how far does it develop the community? I can understand it's a very sensitive question, and as a former bureaucrat, it may be difficult for you to respond, but I think you should take that chance, ma'am.
So here, we have a lot of orders in place. Like I have said, we have been good in policy making, and but the implementation part has not been up to the mark. In fact, Virginius Kaka himself has said that this is, like you said, is a very sensitive topic, and displacement of tribals is of highest concern. And the numbers which are shown on paper, that much of relief has not been given to them, that much of care has not been taken about their rehabilitation packages. And sadly, there is much to do and expect on this front. That is all I would be able to say on this. This is actually a political question, and it is for the policymakers to take stock of.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So with this, we have come to the end of the third edition of National Webinar Series on Development Studies. Professor Ganesh, who was also one of the speakers of the webinar, is not able to join because of certain medical conditions. So our apologies for that. Before we wind up, friends, I want to thank all our distinguished speakers, Dr. Kathiresan ji, Professor Sanjay Singh ji, and Madam Chanchala Devi ji, for their presence and for their invaluable interaction and sharing their practical experiences with us. I also would like to thank all the participants for joining with us. it is raining all over India, and heavy rain predictions are there for next 2 days. Many participants requested us to provide the YouTube link so that even if they are not able to see immediately, later on they can see the interaction. And this has been possible only because of Council for Green Revolution. On behalf of Department of Sociology and on my personal behalf, I am extremely thankful to Mr. Lakshma Reddy ji, Mrs. Leela Lakshma Reddy ji, and Mr. Yashwant for enabling and helping us out technically. My deepest and cordial thanks to my very dear friend Dr. Priya for her constant support. And friends, we again meet on 28th of August with the fourth edition, which is on governance, entrepreneurship, and development. Again, we are trying to bring in the best possible speakers, and the registration link will be posted in the WhatsApp group. So on this note, and tomorrow being a very significant festival for most of us, wishing you all a very happy Ganesh Puja and a very happy weekend. And once again, thanks to each and every speaker, each and every participant, not only on Zoom, but also on YouTube. On that note, thank you very much. So we leave the meeting, and I request all of you to be in touch with us through the chat WhatsApp group for further communication. Thank you so much. Sanjay Singh sir, thank you. Aap ant tak the, aapka bahut bahut dhanyawad. Aap jaise bade logo ke rehne se hum logo ki bhi himmat bahut badhti hai. So thank you so much for staying till the end.
Thank you.
Thank you, friends. So we are ending the meeting. Thank you so much.